3, 4.
Rev up your engine.
Check this out. The Russians are making classic Mustangs, but they're electric cars. It's called AVR Motors. It's a Russian startup company, and they're going to be making these classic 60s-style Mustang bodies, but they're going to be electric cars. And it turns out that they're basically Tesla Model S's, the fast ones, but they have less weight, so they're a little bit faster than the Model S. Now, there's no mention of the price for them yet. They claim that their R67 has 840 horsepower, a range of 315 miles, and 0 to 62 in 2.2 seconds. I guess they go 62 because they go kilometers. It's the Russians for you. They claim it's going to be the quickest muscle car in the world. And you can see, it looks pretty cool. They're just taking the Tesla, though, and they're modifying it. It's got the Tesla battery and everything in it. They're just decided that they're going to make this cool-looking Mustang. And I mean, obviously, it's going to be a low production car. And hey, somebody's looking for a car that looks like that, but has that kind of performance on an electric car, I'm sure they'll sell them all. There's a market out there for stuff like that. And there's plenty enough rich people out there. I remember years ago when Volkswagen decided they were going to make these supercar Porsches and they're going to charge almost $1 million for them. And everybody said, they'll never sell them. They're making 1,000 of those. They'll never sell those. Because most of the supercars, they only make hundreds or less than that. Volkswagen decided they were going to make 1,000. Guess what? Volkswagen had sold all of those 1,000, almost $1 million Porsches before any of them were actually built. So I'm sure the Russians, they build these, hey, they'll be able to sell them all. People want those cool cars that look like the old Mustangs. Hey, all the gangsters will want it for sure. And from what I read, there's a lot of them in Russia. Maybe they'll sell them all there. There's still a lot of millionaires in Russia. Even though the price of oil's down, eventually it'll come back up. Well, if you think that Volvos are reliable but slow, square-looking vehicles, yeah, you might be surprised. They have a top of the line that's called the S60 Polestar. And that S60 Polestar is a very fast car. It goes 0 to 60 in about 4 seconds, which is pretty quick. And it has 415 horsepower, but even more impressive, it's got 494 pound-feet of torque because it's a combination of a turbo four-cylinder engine and a hybrid electric motor. So the rear wheels are driven only by the electric motors, and the front wheels are driven by the gasoline motor. So it is a very fast car. Now, if you got $81,000 lying around and you want to buy a fast Volvo, the whole thing about Volvos is, you know, they're owned by the Chinese now, and they made a pledge a while back saying that they're only going to make hybrid and electric cars in the future. Well, this is a screaming hybrid car. There's no arguing that. If you take a look at it, it's not like the usual ugly Volvo. They get more style points than they used to. Are basically trying to compete with the Genesis and their fancy car, the Genesis G90. But of course, it's going by European style because Volvo, even though China owns them now, they still make a bunch of the stuff in Sweden. So if you always thought Volvos were reliable but ugly looking cars and they weren't all that fast, well, they got a screamer out now if you got $81,000 burning a hole in your pocket. And I mean, they always were relatively dependable. I certainly would rather buy one of those than the Genesis, because I've worked on the Genesis and they're really fun sports cars to drive around the first 100,000 miles. After that, things start to break. Volvos generally last a lot longer. They're more solid-built vehicles. And now, you can get a really fast one if you don't mind the price. Betty Martin says, Scotty, people tell me cold weather decreases your fuel economy, but I had the opposite happen to me. When it was 90-plus in my 2005 Malibu, it got 18 miles a gallon. But when it's below 70, it's getting 20.4 miles a gallon. What gives? It's an older vehicle. You didn't see how many miles it had on it. There's lots of different reasons that things can happen. The reason that people say you get worse gas mileage in colder weather, they're talking about really cold weather. They're talking about, you know, minus 40 or even 20 degrees outside Fahrenheit, because the air is colder. It has to be heated up more to burn inside the engine, so that's loss of thermal efficiency. That's just the way that it goes. Now, you're messing around with different types of stuff. When it gets really hot outside, a lot of old cars, they don't run as well. The heat affects the electronics and stuff, and then when it cools down, the electronics are more efficient. There's a whole list of things that can go one, what they're generally talking about, colder weather and better gas mileage, is the difference between, say, when it's 85 degrees outside and when it's 20 degrees outside. You will notice the difference. They're going to be less efficient. And hilariously enough, a lot of times you're really going to get worse gas mileage in colder weather, because some colder weather places, when it's colder, they use a different kind of gasoline, the winter gas. And the winter gas actually has less British thermal units than the summer gas. So you will get worse gas mileage because it has less energy. Now, it doesn't freeze up and stuff, and people use them in winter in places because it actually pollutes less, but it's less efficient. So a lot of it has to do with the fuel itself today. It wouldn't even matter what the temperature was outside. If you ran the winter fuel that they're running in the summer, you'd find that you'd get worse gas mileage then too, because it's the blend of the fuel. So it's a lot more complicated than people think. Realize nothing is ever all that simple. You have to know all the variables that are input to figure out what the output's going to be. But generally, it's just that when it's cold outside, the air is colder. It's got to be heated up to blow up in the engine, and that's a loss of thermal efficiency. Automotive tech said, I need help. Well, don't we all? I got a 2012 Mazda 3, 175,000 miles. I'm not knowledgeable about fluids. And someone said, put Lucas Oil Stabilizer high mileage to add in with my 0W20 oil. Later, I realized they're too thick. I think I made a mistake. Will it ruin my engine if I use it for 5,000 miles? What should I do? All right. One, I would change it out. Now, it's thicker. You don't want to take chance with a car that's got 175,000 miles on it. Now, realize that there is Lucas Oil Stabilizer of two types. There's the old style that's thick, and there's the new style that's thin. If you do want to use it, buy the new thin one, and that's okay to use. But do not use that heavy stuff. It's as thick as like a SDP oil treatment was when I was a kid, and that was like molasses going downhill in January, thick as can be. So if you want, I would change it now. And if you want to get the lightweight one, they have a modern one. You can do that if you wanted to. But take that stuff out. It's too thick. You don't want to wear an engine out because something dumb like that. It's worn already. Who knows when it's going to break with 175,000 miles. Don't push it. Don Rest says, you can pay me now or you can pay me later. Scotty, remember that car commercial? I'm thinking all those turbo 1.5 engines after 100,000 miles. Have you seen these things go more than 150,000 miles without wearing? Well, really, I haven't. Almost all the ones I've seen, they all wore. That's just common sense. And that is, you can pay me now and you can pay me later, not or. Because, of course, modern cars are expensive. They're charging a lot of money for them, right? So you're paying a lot of money for the car. And it's not going to last as long with the turbo. So if you want to fix it later, you have to pay them later. So you're paying on both ends of it. My advice, as I've been saying for quite some time, I'm not a fan of small engine that has turbochargers on it. They're only going to wear out faster, even if you maintain them. And I know the average American. I've been working on cars for 52 years for them. Many people do very little maintenance. And if you have a small turbocharged engine and you don't maintain it, it's going to wear out even faster. So, not such a smart idea. But it's not you can pay me now or you can pay me later. It's you can pay me now and you can pay me later if you buy one of those. Elijah 25 says, Scotty, I got a 2010 Ford Explorer V6, 120,000 miles. It needs a new or rebuilt tranny because reverse gear is gone. I'm not sure if I'm going to keep it. It's got 120,000 miles and it's an 11-year-old Ford Explorer. It is not worth much money. I try to sell it as is. If it goes forward but not back up, tell people reverse is gone, but you can drive it forward. See what people offer you for it. Now, if they don't offer you much, see what it costs to put a junkyard transmission, a used one. And if you put that in and you can get a lot more money selling it, go that route. But I wouldn't keep it myself. It's pretty much through its lifespan. It's about the average of those things. You see, the transmission's already broken. If you can get it fixed cheap and then sell it for money, great. But try selling it the way it is now. If you can get enough, just get rid of it and don't get into a rat's nest of problems on something that's probably wearing out anyways. Omer Campos 2 says, I got a Tacoma 95 extended cab, manual transmission, 2.4 liter four-cylinder engine. I got it from the second owner. It starts perfectly fine cold, but it cranks and won't start till the third or fourth try when it's hot. I tried spark plugs and all kinds of stuff. Help. All right, I can tell you what's happening is it's old. And as they get old, the fuel injectors will tend to leak a little bit. When an engine is ice cold, extra fuel makes it start fine. So it'll always start cold. But when it gets hot, if those injectors are dripping, that floods the engine out. So while you're cranking it, the engine's flooded. And after the third or fourth try, the engine's spun enough to unflood the engine, and then it'll start up. Now, you can try my video, how to clean fuel injectors without removal and have them pressure cleaned. Maybe that'll help. To 95, you might need new injectors. Now, you can buy a set of four injectors cheaply enough, remanufactured from a good company, and put them in. You can even put them in yourself. And that thing is pretty easy to work on. It's not rocket science. And that might fix it, but sometimes cleaning will fix it. But I mean, if it always starts after the third or fourth crank and you don't care, just keep driving it that way. I got customers driven his 8 years that way and it still does it, and he's still driving it. He just knows that if he drives a while, eats lunch and gets in, it's going to be a little hard to start, and he doesn't care. He won't spend any money on it. So if you never want to miss another one of my new car repair videos, remember to ring that bell.